Tonight, St. Lucia and other Caribbean leaders are planning to discuss the issue of criminal deportees in the aftermath of last Tuesday's victory by real estate mogul Donald Trump in U.S. presidential elections. A veteran Calypsonian is a man traveling a path much different than in his earlier years. A group of Form 5 secondary school students teach mathematics to younger counterparts as part of activities to mark Maths Month. And the Salvation Army has launched its annual Christmas kettle drive. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Monday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polio. Our top story. St. Lucia and other Caribbean leaders are planning to discuss the issue of criminal deportees in the aftermath of last Tuesday's victory by real estate mogul Donald Trump in U.S. presidential elections. The president-elect campaigned on a promise to deport the 11 million people who are living illegally in the United States. Over the weekend, in his first television interview after his shocking success at the polls, the 70-year-old told his interviewer that upon his inauguration in January of 2017, efforts will be intensified to ensure that illegal residents who are involved in crime are either imprisoned or deported. Ahead of today's cabinet meeting, the island's national security minister revealed that regional heads are very concerned about the possible fallout. DBS's Don Nicholas begins our news coverage.
Now that Donald Trump has assumed the presidency of the United States, many countries fear that he will make good on his promise to get rid of millions of immigrants in the United States, and this will definitely include the criminal elements over there. The issue of criminal deportees has always been a burning one for Caribbean countries in terms of those countries being able to absorb such elements. St. Lucia's National Security Minister Herman Gil Francis told the media that Caribbean prime ministers will be convening a meeting and that the issue of criminal deportees will be high up on the agenda.
This is an important juncture in our history. And I think that the prime ministers of the Caribbean islands will meet and will have some dialogue with the new president. I don't want to jump to conclusions as to what will happen, but I think the ministers will be proactive in having some audience with them and telling them of their concerns.
Minister Francis also profited the opportunity to update the media on the reopening of the forensic lab. He said his government is in discussion with overseas counterparts.
We are in discussion with an individual from Trinidad and Tobago. He owns his own lab in Trinidad, which is utilized by the government of Trinidad and Tobago, and a lot of private sector persons use that lab. He's going to be sending a proposal to us shortly, and we're going to have discussions with him. He has been here, he has visited the lab, and he said that he's very impressed with the equipment that the lab has. But then he wants to do this gap analysis, and after that has been done, he is going to make a proposal to the government of St. Lucia, and we will decide whether we should accept or not.
The minister also indicated to reporters that he is awaiting a report from the newly appointed Director of Public Prosecutions later this week on the status of the Impacts report and the Lamberts Academy scam. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Remembrance Day was observed here on Sunday, which marked the 102nd anniversary of the First World War. To mark the occasion, a military parade was held at the Derek Walcott Square, followed by the laying of ceremonial wreaths at George V Park. The St. Lucia branch of the Royal Commonwealth Ex-Service League annual reunion ceremony and a brunch were held at the official residence of the Prime Minister. We have a report from Alex Busquet.
President of the Veterans Association, Mr. Haynes Cyril, spoke of his only remaining fellow veteran soldier who served with him in battle but died on Saturday, November 12th.
I would like very much for a minute silence for a veteran who died yesterday. He was 92 years and he died yesterday, and he's the only one remain here in St. Lucia, who served with me in the Caribbean Regiment for 2 years. And that was a surprise to me. I received the information that he died. I would like you to stand for a minute silent for me, please.
Mr. Cyril later told of his first experience of the reality of war in the Atlantic Ocean.
When the convoy started bombing, being bombed by German submarines, that was our first experience. Ships scattered in different directions. My ship went through the Mediterranean Sea, through Gibraltar, and we travel to right down to Egypt, not Egypt, so sorry, to Italy. And that's where we were in the enemy's territory. And he was the only one and remained in St. Lucia to remind me of the last World War.
Although the circumstances that have brought us here this morning, and as elaborated by the history given by Mr. Springer and indeed by Mr. Cyril, though those circumstances are solemn and tragic, and it is good for us to hear it over and over again, but the coming together on that occasion, it's supposed to be a festive occasion. As Mr. Cherubin says, it's a party.
This year's Remembrance Day celebrations began with a street parade involving officers of the Royal St. Lucia Police Force, the Fire Brigade, the St. Lucia Air and Seaports Authority, and the Royal Commonwealth Ex-Service League. They all paraded around the city circuit, then wound up at the official residence of the Prime Minister. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Alex Bousquet.
We continue the broadcast with news that, in keeping with changes in international oil prices and government's application of the modified market pass-through petroleum pricing mechanism, the retail prices of gasoline unleaded, diesel per gallon, and the LPG 2022 and 100-pound cylinders changed from today. The price of diesel per liter and kerosene remains unchanged. Gasoline from $2.44 to $2.45 per liter, or from $11.09 to $11.15 per gallon. In the case of diesel, from $10.44 to $10.46 per gallon. The 20-pound cylinder from $26.89 to $27.74 per cylinder. 22-pound cylinder from $29.86 to $30.79 per cylinder. The 100-pound cylinder from $181.10 to $185.34 per cylinder. Kerosene remains at $1.41 per liter, or $6.39 per gallon. Diesel remains at $2.30 per liter. The public is informed that the retail prices of fuel products will be next adjusted on Monday, December the 5th, 2016. Ahead of plans to reduce the VAT rate from 15% to 12.5% by February the 1st of 2017, the minister in the Ministry of Finance says that government is deliberating on recommendations from the Caribbean Development Bank to possibly cut down on the number of items on the VAT exemption list. Don Nicholas tells us more.
Minister in the Ministry of Finance, Dr. Ubaldus Raymond, says the removal of VAT is part of the Five to Stay Alive plan. He also spoke of the need to cut on the VAT exemption list. He says there is a need to come up with a system that works in the best interest of all involved. He added that the 2.5% VAT reduction, which the government just announced, is just the first phase of a plan by the government to reduce on VAT.
The 2.5 that we announced is just the first phase of the reductions. We are hoping to have a further reduction sometime next year. The announcement will be made very early in the year, sometime January or February.
The need to remove some of the items on the exemption list was one of the recommendations made by the CDB. As to whether government would act on those recommendations, Dr. Raymond could not say. What he did say is that government is still deliberating on the matter.
The administrative costs, the burdensome administration, that just to undertake the VAT with all of these exemptions, you're talking about 131 exempted items, 107 zero-rated items. This is actually causing more pain to the administrator and the taxpayer, in referring to businesses. So in light of all of these things here, they are recommending that these items be removed.
The minister also spoke about the size of the public service, indicating that government had no intention of downsizing that sector. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, the first Brazilian parliamentarian and business mission to St. Lucia opened here today at the Bay Gardens Hotel. The business session of the forum started this morning with three major addresses aimed at setting the framework for the business discussions. The Brazilian mission stay on the island until the 17th of this month will also involve visits to V4, Sufre and Canneries, exchanges with identified local business partners, and visits to local business centers and private entities.
The Brazilian parliamentarians and business mission to St. Lucia will serve to facilitate dialogue between local and Brazilian entrepreneurs to explore new business opportunities. The Brazilian ambassador highlighted the need for translation volunteers in order to move the process forward.
We perhaps will need some volunteers. So those who think that they might volunteer translation between Portuguese and English are welcome at the Brazilian embassy during the matchmaking rounds, conversations. And it's also relevant to take into account that the Brazilians, we Brazilians understand Spanish. We can understand Spanish. So even if you don't speak Portuguese, but if you do speak Spanish, if you speak slowly and clearly, it can be understood by the Brazilian delegation.
This, according to officials, can serve to stimulate foreign investment. Minister in the Ministry of External Affairs, Sarah Flood Bobra, emphasized the importance of face-to-face interaction.
But there is nothing like a face-to-face meeting among business people if we have to drive business. And even in my experiences as a former minister, when we worked on a number of projects, for example, when we commissioned the Bordelais Correctional Facility during my time as Minister for Home Affairs, or when we established the first shelter for battered women when I was the Minister for Gender Relations. You could have email discussions, you could have telephone conversations, but unless there is a meeting, a connection of people face to face, you have not really had a meeting yet.
Minister Bobra is hoping that there will be numerous business opportunities there for the taking. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Time now for Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske and you're watching Street Vibes. Today, it's Open Mic Monday. The people speak to an open mic.
The most important thing right now, I would like to see the government do things right for the people. People are more important in this country. That is why I say when you have an office or even if you have a supermarket and nobody's coming in your supermarket, it doesn't make any sense. You will just have a dry supermarket. You must take care of the people. People are first and put people first. And I know this government gonna put people first. Thank you very much.
I have a concern about the status of the Calypso Association in St. Lucia. And I guess music overall in St. Lucia and the people that supposedly are representatives of it on the island. Really and truly what I would like to see, for sure, I would like to see the Calypso Association reform, come back to life, and really and truly fulfill its purpose and the mandate which was given to it by by the people and for the Calypsonians themselves to take a greater interest in what is theirs. I mean, look at what happened there with Get Through and all the fundraising and people within the association who are suffering from cancer and all of these things. If we had a thriving Calypso Association, I am certain, or for that matter, if we had a thriving music, I mean, people like to say we have a music industry in St. Lucia, but I don't believe we have an industry. We have a music scene, but we don't have an industry, really and truly, because if we had an industry, then it would be more industrious.
It is time for our politicians to change them kind of laws they have, stupid laws, okay? The minute I'm here, a little girl go to the hospital, she pregnant, she underage, she about 11, 12 years, and you have to wait for the mother or the father or somebody bring report to me. From the time you go to the hospital, that's evidence that you're underage. So the nurses, the doctors have to call the police, and the police have to do the investigation. Don't tell about mother, father, have to go to the law. No. To me, I feel that law was there in them slavery days, where our slave masters could do our kids anything and get away with that. It's now we got to change that law. Okay? And them politicians, okay? They're just thief, but they want to jail you if you thief a leaf. Tell them to change that law.
I would like to find out. We have a problem, and it's concerning the school children. What time school commences and what time school dismisses? When you look at it, there are no grown-ups on the streets now, only school children in the stores, toilets, and it's affecting the public. When you talk to them, they curse you, they insult you, and so forth. Isn't there a law for that? In my days, when it was 6 o'clock, I was in already. I mean, what are the school children doing on the streets after school? They're supposed to be home. Parents supposed to know where their children are.
I am very disappointed in Mr. Chastney for not attending this parade. I think that people die for us, and I think he should do this no respect. I don't care what you say, he might go overseas or whatever. I think he should show some respect for the, how do you call him? For the fallen soldiers. I think he should show more respect for them.
Yeah, what's affecting me right now, I'm very much concerned about the Castries Harbour, the front. I mean, are we waiting for another Monsion with a bus with about 15, 20 people on board to just go over? I'm pleading on to the government, please, if they could just put a crash barrier, that would really, really help, you know, and saves more lives. Look at just what happened over the weekend. Hold on beyond that, at least that person was lucky enough to come out.
Good morning. Mr. Isaac, I talked to the former government, asking them to fix up the health center yard, so that we on a wheelchair will get access to it. It ain't happen. Please, as you there, help us with that. Fix up the health center yard, so that we could have access to it for the wheelchairs.
There is a little issue about the school children on the street. Something like a young woman that has sweat so much without a panty shield on. How can them small children in school be on a school bench from 8 until 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 in the night? That looking so nasty and so bad. They're supposed to be better than that. At least, right now the CXC is coming up. That's time for you to study your schoolwork and stuff. And don't roam the street like it's vacancies you all are looking for.
That was the Vibes on the Street with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Street. With that, we'll take you right back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, a veteran Calypsonian is a man traveling a path much different than in his earlier years. And the two of the island's primary schools host students from a similar number of local secondary schools who play the role of teachers in a particular subject. Welcome back to the broadcast. A veteran Calypsonian is currently a man traveling a path much different than in his earlier years. Following several years of trial and failure, the last five marking the commencement of a road to recovery, the People's King has made a major commitment. He is hoping that this remarkable feat will serve as an inspiration to others. Known to St. Lucians by his stage name, the Ashanti, the 59-year-old performer tied the knot with Malene on Saturday at the Minor Basilica. Inspired to make a change for the better after being awarded the St. Lucia Medal of Merit Silver for his contribution to the arts in 2014, Herman Hippolyte, a former crack addict, set along the path to sobriety.
What really gave me the change is when I got my award. Right, when I got my award from the government. That's in what year? I think 2015, I got my award, right? I got my silver award. That changed me more. I said to myself that if you have an award, if you have this kind of award, you cannot be on the streets like a vagrant. You have to change your whole life around. So that's where the turnaround came from there.
Yeah. Hippolyte marks his wedding as the climax of a concerted effort to leave his demons in his past.
I personally, that was one of the best days of my life, you know, because I married because I know all the struggles I went through, and I met a good wife, my wife right now. I met that good wife who take me off and talk to me and put me to the ceiling and talk to me and tell me, well, you know, I cannot let my life go away like that. You understand? I just changed my life around. I don't know, I just started going to church. I joined the cathedral choir. From there, and I joined the cathedral choir, and I just started working and just pick up myself from there.
Ashanti has expressed the hope that his story will be an example to others. The three-time Calypso monarch cited that continued support by loved ones allowed him to transition to a place where he can once again perform his craft and command the stage.
I got support because we went through our little struggles, and sometimes she had to go to her bosses and tell them, you give me trouble and things, and they had to call me and put me to sit down and talk to me and tell me, well, you know, that's not the way it's supposed to be. But we never like to say, well, if we have a little trouble, we make noise. We go home, we cool out, we talk together, we talk it out. So, you know, so it is not already. So all the counseling I did for the marriage, I know about that.
Ashanti is looking forward to the upcoming Calypso season and already has a song lined up called Change, a title befitting of his story. In other news, the island's minister with responsibility for health and wellness is recommending that people whose circumstances are favorable opt to become foster parents. The former trade unionist says that this is in an effort to remove abused children from their current unfavorable environments. We get the details from Don Nicholas.
According to Health Minister Mary Isaac, government is in the process of reviewing the legislation as well as devising new policies to deal with the scourge of child abuse. The minister called for more persons to demonstrate their willingness to serve as foster parents.
We cannot just accept that you can slap a child or you can, you know, because they grow up thinking that it's okay, and you see the adults are slapping each other and the adults are abusing each other. So it is starting from the roots, you know, it starts from the roots, and we have to try to find ways of stomping this out of our culture.
The minister herself has decided to lead by example. She now has two underprivileged children in her care.
I want to appeal to all the people of St. Lucia, the mothers out there, people who can assist to help us take these children out of the abusive situation. I have taken two such children out of, you know, abusive situations or potentially abusive situations, but there are also parents who It really has nothing to do with abuse per se. It's just poverty that they really lack the necessary resources to take care of a child.
The minister noted that many children are sexually abused or come from impoverished families or are subjected to an environment prone to violence. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Two of the island's primary schools hosted students from a similar number of local secondary schools who played the role of teachers in a particular subject. This formed a part of activities to mark a major observance. Alex Buske provides the details.
Over the past 4 years, the Tapion Private School has accommodated Form 5 students of the Leon Hess Comprehensive Secondary School to teach maths during Mathematics Month for District 3 under the We Can Teach 2 program. The student spent this morning at the school where they taught the subject at the primary level.
They teach multiplication, addition, whatever the teachers want them to teach. So before they come, they prepare to teach the subject, the topic, and then they come in and they teach. A very, very good initiative by Leon Hess, because what it does, when students are able to explain mathematics to other children, to other students like themselves, they in turn get better at it, and the children sometimes learn even better from their peers.
Chanel Jules, a Form 5 student of the Leon Hess Comprehensive Secondary School, who is also the public relations officer of the We Can Teach 2 program, said they were more than happy to perform this exercise.
Join this mathematics program in order to help to use our basic mathematics knowledge and skills to help pass it down to the younger students of the Tapio Primary School. We elected to start up because we know that mathematics is an important aspect or subject in someone's lives. So we were very elated to start, and we know that this will be a good experience for us and the students. In order for some of us who would like to be a teacher in a later life, it will help us experience, help us communicate better with children and us.
9 student teachers of the Leon Hess School participated in the maths program at the Tapio School on Monday. A similar exercise took place at the Masha Combined School, featuring students of the Entrepo Secondary School.
Well, mathematics, you know, has been an Achilles heel in our education system. We want to sensitize people as to mathematics. We know that it is fun. We want to sensitize the public. I mean, we feel that from what we have been doing, we're giving mathematics some good publicity. Last week we had our quiz, and this week we can teach too. At the end of the month, we are supposed to have a rally on the square with all the schools in the districts.
For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
Local furniture and electrical superstore Courts will be hosting the 8th annual Schools Reading Competition on Wednesday in St. Kitts and Nevis. The company hosted the national level of the competition on October 14th and saw 8 finalists from districts across the island competing for $2,000 in cash plus $2,000 for their school. In the end, Ms. Keishon Alphonse, student of the Soufre Primary School, wowed both audience and judges alike and was announced the winner of the St. Lucia leg of the competition. Ms. Alphonse will represent St. Lucia at the OACS finals and will compete against the winners from Antigua and Barbuda, Dominica, Grenada, St. Kitts and Nevis, and St. Vincent and the Grenadines. The winner at the OACS finals will win an additional $5,000 in cash plus $5,000 for his or her school. First runner-up will receive $3,000 and second runner-up $2,000. All other participants will get $1,000 cash from Courts. They will also receive a laptop from the superstore and certificates of participation. Keishon and her guardian, as well as all the delegates from the OECS, will be flown to St. Kitts and Nevis on Tuesday, November 15th, for the competition, with all expenses paid by Courts. When we come back in just a moment, the St. Lucia leg of Global Entrepreneurship Week opened today. Thank you so much for staying with the broadcast. The St. Lucia leg of Global Entrepreneurship Week opened today. It coincides with Business Month. During 1 week each November, thousands of events and competitions in 160 countries inspire millions to engage in entrepreneurial activity while connecting them to potential collaborators, mentors, and even investors.
Global Entrepreneurial Week is observed annually by 182 countries. On Monday, St. Lucia joined the rest of the world in the commemoration. Chamber of Commerce officials organized what they called a speed networking session, which served to put the business community in touch with key institutions such as the banks, among others.
The speed networking session aims to connect entrepreneurs from across the island with a few professionals within the field, a few being maybe accountants, bankers, and so on. We understand that entrepreneurs don't interact with those individuals on a daily basis, seeing that they're mostly at work. So the Speed Networking Forum allows them the opportunity to meet with those individuals that may play an integral part in their business, and also get the opportunity to dialogue with them and ask them a few burning questions that they have. on their hearts for their business and help them to move forward.
Global Entrepreneurial Week runs from November 14th to 20th. Some 70 persons participated in Monday's exercise. A variety of businesses were represented at the forum.
We actually have a group of 70 entrepreneurs here at the at Sandals Halcyon, a few of them being across the sectors of media, social media, shoe repair, we have shoe rehab, we have a few businesses in the food industry, crumbs as well from Viewfort. So we have quite a bit of young entrepreneurs, young budding entrepreneurs here at the activity today.
Organizers are hoping that more young people will develop the entrepreneurial spirit. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
In other news, the Salvation Army on Thursday launched its annual Christmas Kettle Drive. The event was held at the First Caribbean International Bank at Rodney Bay.
We had KFC, we had Courts, we had Massey, we had quite a number of business people, Northwestern, amongst others. And as you know, the proceeds from the kettle is used for our Christmas program specifically. Last year, we were able to give out 800 parcels, grocery parcels, to families all across St. Lucia. This year, we're aiming even higher than that. We want to give out at least 1,000.
The Salvation Army, according to Captain Mitchell, will also organize fun days for less fortunate children.
Every year, you'll see people with their Christmas trees. You'll see the Santa, the stores will have their pretty lights and all of that. And somewhere you're going to see a little Salvationist ringing a bell and soliciting a donation from the great people of St. Lucia, who have always participated consistently. And we use this money to help make Christmas great for someone who is less fortunate than ourselves.
The Salvation Army commander has beseeched members of the public to place donations in Christmas kettles wherever one is available, no matter how small, to help in bringing good cheer to the needy during the festive season. In other news, the Ministry of Social Transformation Friday held a one-day workshop for young and professionals to help them master the art of public speaking. Don Nicholas reports.
The Ministry of Social Transformation organized a seminar to help participants harness their skills as public speakers. It forms part of activities to mark November, designated Business Month. It also covered impromptu speeches.
Today we are going to focus on how do you sell yourself in 20 to 30 minutes, to 30 seconds or 60 seconds by just articulating what do you do and why you do it.
Facilitators expressed concern about the inability of young people in particular to handle interviews and deliver platform speeches.
There's a general lack, especially for our young people, because you have all kind of infiltration of different cultures. And you find now St. Lucians speak like Jamaicans, Jamaicans speak like Americans. So sometimes it's difficult to understand the techniques as to how we can sell ourselves, especially in terms of what you do. And I think public speaking is a skill that can be learned. And we, as Toastmasters, we take the opportunity to teach people how to market yourself.
The seminar ended on Friday. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues with Brian Calixt.
We start off with news on rugby. The first ever Beach Rugby Fives tournament was hosted by the St. Lucia Rugby Football Union yesterday at the VG Beach. The one-day tournament, which was held at the VG Beach, did not disappoint as teams get up to claim bragging rights of being the first champs of Beach Rugby in St. Lucia and to take home the cash prize on offer. Le Sport Rugby walked away as the winning female team, winning all three matches at 3-0, 6-2 and 5-2 against Whiptail Warriors. Top scorers for the winning team were Nelta Samuel, Renetta Fredericks and Marlene Sherry. Rogues, led by team captain Irwin Joseph, won all three matches as well against the male team of Whiptail Warriors. The scores of the matches were 8-3, 9-4 and 8-5. The top scorers of the Rogues team were Nigman Lescaris, Jerry Charles, and Irving Joseph. The initiative was well received by newcomers who played for various teams and by supporters who energetically cheered for their teams. The St. Lucia Rugby Football Union was pleased to witness the success of this initiative and plans to make it an annual event. In swimming, the 26th OECS Swimming Championships concluded at the Shrewsbury Aquatic Centre in St. Vincent and the Grenadines over the last weekend. Grenada emerged winners with Antigua secure in second spot and St. Lucia in third position. Prior to the St. Lucia team leaving for the championships, team members participated in a fundraising swimathon which was held at the Rodney Heights Aquatic Centre. The highlight of the swimathon was the guest appearance of Olympians Carrie-Anne Payne and her husband David Carey, also an Olympian. Both motivated the national team as well as interested swimmers by interacting and answering questions. In dominoes, the last round of matches in the preliminary stage of the Intercommercial House Domino competition concluded last Thursday. In Group A, Sanders Halsham with 66 points defeated Beachcomber 63 points and Loose Leg 59 points. The top scorers for Sanders Halsham was Marlene DeMille with 16 points, while for Beachcomber it was Thompson Dalkan with 15 points, and for Loose Leg it was Darton Charles with 15 points. In Group B, Peter and Company distributors Spoonoff with 78 points, defeated Ministry of Infrastructure 74 points, and Winjama 49 points. The top scorers for Peter and Company Spoonoff, McKelly with 18 points, the Ministry of Infrastructure Shirl Honorville with 18 points, and for Winjama it was Bernard George with 11 points. The knockout round commences this evening. The eliminator, Scotiabank, takes on Peter and Company Distribution Smirnoff and Beachcomber, while tomorrow from 6:30 p.m. will be the quarterfinals. MNC Drug Store, they take on the St. Lucia Fire Service and the winner of the eliminator. Stay tuned, more sports after the break.
You're just in time for the usual reminder. St. Lucia and other Caribbean leaders are planning to discuss the issue of criminal deportees in the aftermath of last Tuesday's victory by real estate mogul Donald Trump in U.S. presidential elections. A veteran Calypsonian is a man traveling a path much different than in his earlier years. A group of Form 5 secondary school students teach mathematics to younger counterparts as part of activities to mark Mass Month. And the Salvation Army has launched its annual Christmas kettle drive. And that's the DBS News World. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the broadcast. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polion, wishing you a very good evening. Good night.